This is not going to be a formalized type of thing. It's going to be something that I want to share with you all the years that I've been in the business, especially working on the selling floor in retail, and of course, being in wholesale for 20 years. So the combination of 30 and 20 plus 4 years teaching has given me a good background and understanding the business. My heart will always be with the independent. Bye-bye versus buy. Bye-bye is the number of walks we have on a daily basis. Forget the economy, forget weather, the gloom and doom. If we spent more time working on the upbeat and the positive approach to business as opposed to the downside and the gloom and doom, if we spent more time giving our salespeople truly a training experience, can you imagine that? What we can do in business, you cannot compete with everybody else. Forget about it. It doesn't work. You compete with yourself. And you compete by going out, recruiting, and hiring the best people for your business. You know, it blows my mind. It blows my mind because when I go into stores and I experience somebody who cannot answer my question, who cannot give me anything I need to know about product except that it's comfortable. What the hell is it comfortable about? Think about that. I had a salesperson in Detroit pulled out the footbed. Said, this is why I don't like Clarks. They don't glue their footbeds. It was a removable footbed. Now, you know what's sad about it? That person's on the floor all day. I'm not there to tell them that, no, that's not right. It's not broke. He didn't know I was from Clarks. He was on his business card, my business card. And then he became a little nervous. But here's the deal. I know that you have to build a foundation. A foundation meaning that if you're going to have a successful business, I'm telling you that what you've got to do is go out and recruit the right people. Sometime, and this business is notorious, somebody drops out today, we go out and hire somebody tomorrow, we put them on the floor. They have no clue what they're selling or how to talk or the social skills. They don't understand the primary purpose of selling is the benefit of the customer. To sell the benefit to the customer, the basic objective of any presentation is to provide and present the customer with value of benefits to be gained greater than the price to be paid. There's no such thing as it's too high of a price. First of all, when a customer walks into the store, they look at the bottom of the shoe. And at the bottom of the shoe, it says $140. That price exceeds the value to them at that point. But what I have found out, there are great retailers who take the time to train their people. They train their people so that they understand what it is the customer is going to want or need. There's a difference. People need something, it's urgency, sense of. But you know what the want is? It's a desire. It's a desire to buy something in addition. In fact, as a matter of fact, 40% of people that come in your store, and I want you to think about this, because we're going to spend time on it. Building a sale, I call it add-on, not extra. Extra has connotations of not necessary, not important. Building a sale today is imperative to your business because we have fewer footsteps coming into the stores today. So you have to build with each customer a multiple sale. It's called choice. And that's another area. I was in the store last week. I'm shopping with my wife. We walked in. And it's one of the notable stores. There's people who kind of presented, this four pair or more on the floor type of thing. Which, by the way, I find very few stores offer choice or selection. Boy, you want to talk about an opportunity. You want to talk about a great opportunity to build your volume and to build sales, to grow. You don't want to survive. You want to grow. And when we went into the store, it was okay. I was pleased with the approach. And then my wife wanted this shoe, and the salesperson came out with four boxes. Now, I didn't let her know I was in the shoe business. By the way, do we not have the experience that we also go out as a customer? I could be ruthless too, because I have high expectations. Today I think it's changing. I'm not so sure people have high expectations anymore, because when they can get on the phone and order something over the phone or go on the internet and have that package the next day without hassle, maybe that's where it's going. We could stop it. And look, I'm not taking anything away from the internet, because I think it's a great operation and a great opportunity for people. There's a balance. That's why if you're in the people business simply means that the people you have on the floor will make that difference, because they have contact with that customer. I gotta read something. Oh, let me go back to my story. He brought out the four pair of shoes, and I was chuckling because I said, gee, that's nice of you. My wife wanted that, and you're bringing out four. I said, what's in the other shoes? She said, oh, and she opened them up. I said, you know, I want to recognize you now. I want to applaud you for making an attempt. And we did buy two pair of shoes, because it's magic. When you go in to buy, people have a desirability to buy as opposed to a resistance to buy. Think of it that way. It's like the escalator, up and down. It's never going to both be together. Either it's going to be down and up, or it's going to be down here, and the resistance to buy goes up. Every time a customer comes into your store. And we bought the two pair, and I complimented her. I said, this was a great experience. Because most of the time, we don't offer the choice of something versus something. Rather, we offer something versus nothing. And when we'll get into that, I will demonstrate it. Here's what I'm talking about. When I started out in 1958, training was imperative. You had to go to that back stock room, work in that back stock room for 2 to 3 to 4 weeks. And the retailer I worked for was noted for their training. We were specialists in that. We set aside a budget. We set aside Tuesday night and Thursday night to train people. We had workshops on Saturday morning and get them into the stores, and they're all geared up, they're all self-motivated, they're excited, they're enthused, and so forth and so forth. It's disappeared. We are looking at other areas. Marketing. Nothing wrong with marketing. You need it. It's an attention getter. It doesn't sell one pair of shoes. The salesperson sells the shoe. And we put those shoes in her hand after we decide what brand you're going to have. I hope it's ours. And when they get those shoes, if they know nothing about that shoe or they just say it's comfortable, you can hear that anywhere. You can hear that anywhere. So I want to build the foundation. I just gave you some bits and pieces before we get to those bits and pieces, and kind of focus in on them a little more. The foundation first is, I hear complaints about, where do you find people? Let me just give you a quick one. You better be looking all the time and not wait until Joe leaves and calls in tomorrow and says he quit. I'm going to say this about the retail business. It's a tough business right now to get people to come into. Don't you dare go to art and interview people. Don't you dare. But you know where you can go? You can go to a 2-year business school. I taught there. They have job placement. What a golden opportunity for somebody to break into the retail business. Who knows what kind of talent you're going to get? And then they have opportunities, maybe opportunity for upward mobility. You can go there. I'm telling you, job placement has a commitment to the school that they need to have a certain amount of people get a job, which is called 94%. Now, I know, I used to go do presentations as well as teach, and I picked up people who were jewels. They had talent. Even though they would stay with the company I worked for, they would get a taste of what it was like to work in the retail business, and some of them went on and moved. I have one right back there that worked when he was 12 years old for me. There are opportunities. The other opportunity is, folks, take a look at unemployed people who don't have a clue where to get a job. You've got senior citizens. I know who they are. You've got senior citizens. You've got unemployed people. You got housewives who might want to take a break in the afternoon and go out and have a job for 2 to 3, 4 hours and get that discount. But you can get people, you've got to build a staff that's pretty well balanced, a good mix of people. It works. Now, number two, the training, make it simple. Make it simple. Training can be as follows. Put them in the back stock room. Let them learn where the product is. Let them learn about the product, the different vendors, the different use, the different categories. Is it active sport? Is it casual? Is it dress casual? Is it dress? Let them know that. Because you can build. You can build. You can build from that. The other thing to do is let them learn how to merchandise a sale. I'd love to have you take your people on a Saturday morning, give them 5 minutes to go to the back stock, after they learn the stock, and bring out a selection of four pair or more for the customer, and have them explain each shoe that they brought out, what it was going to stand for, and what need would it fulfill that customer. Because let me tell you something, there is so much opportunity to expand that sale. You show one shoe, you only get one pair sold, maybe. You show a multiple sale, and you're going to get, I'll guarantee you, two pair at least. Think about it. Two pair at least versus one. Number three, the Braddock device, if you use it, I worked with Mr. Charles Braddock from Syracuse, New York. The purpose of that Braddock device was to get the customer seated. It's a guide, and don't use it as a specific size. It don't work. It's a great tool to get the customer seated. That's what you got to do. In this business, by the way, how the hell can you sell a pair of shoes if they're not seated?
Somebody here?
Think about it. Take their shoes off. Hide the damn shoes. Then you can do your measuring, both feet. And what will the customer say? This is the first time I've had my feet measured in 20 years. 20 years. Isn't that what you're looking for? A competitive edge? Your only competitive edge is going to come from those people. You've got to understand that. The training, again, so important. You get them to merchandise the sale. And the other thing you do is you actually let them perform for you a situation with a customer coming in. Give them those role plays. Role plays, as corny as I used to think they were, work. Let me tell you, every Saturday morning you should take time aside to call it, maybe we get together, now is the time. And what you do with that, you get your people to perform, you help them. Every new product, boy, I'd love to see come fall, with all the high tech, with all the brands that are putting so much more into their footwear, I'd love to see what kind of product knowledge are you going to teach them. Every shoe that comes in should have a product knowledge sheet. Every shoe that comes in, you should have a book made up of the features and benefits. If you don't know what that means, I can tell you what it means. Feature is something about the shoe. It's a characteristic, the advantages, what that characteristic does, and the benefit is what it does for the customer. And where do we make the mistake? We try to sell the customer the feature because we can't tell them anything else. They don't buy features. The customer buys benefits. It's a reason to buy. It says, today I'm going to be better off than tomorrow. You're providing that customer with a solution to their problem. You see what happens? Now, you work on that. Set aside a budget. I'm telling you, give it some time. You can use your vendors for your resources as far as training information. They all have great training information. You want to start? Start with us. That's what's in your folder. I put a book on the Wave Construction, and I put a book in there that's got the Young New Construction. And I'll tell you what. You start working people that way, you get them into a system. Look, I've been coaching baseball for 40 years. You know when the kids come out of the car the first time, parents drop them off, they get up the bat, where the hell do you think they go after they hit the ball? Third base. Second base. Then you teach them how to go to first, second, third, and home. Repetition, habit is the crosswords of learning. That's what you've got to have. A program that you know that you establish, it's got to come from upper management. It's got to be something that management believes in. It starts at the top, and if it doesn't start at the top, it ain't starting at all. Shame on us.